You're back with your girls, Misa and Mia from, you already know, it's Eminem Live Radio, and it's the moment you all have been waiting for.
Yes, yes, that's right, Misa. His laid-back, distinctive flow is an addition to him being the creative wordsmith that he is. Repping the 901-615, he's paving his own way through his artistry and overall impact, all with the tribe by his side. His new mixtape, Lowercase Tape, is out right now. We're about to talk to the mastermind behind it all. We want to welcome National Recording artist, No Big Deal, back to the show. Hey, Dill, what's going on?
What up? How y'all feeling, man?
Listen, we're feeling good. Listen, now, I think the last time we had you on the show was when Canopy dropped. Ooh, so this is really long overdue.
Right.
So we're so glad to have you, bro. Thank you so much for taking the time to hang out with us back here on Eminem Live Radio.
Yeah, it's always a pleasure with you guys.
Man,
sure.
We really appreciate it. Now, before we get into this tape right here, I want to talk about A3C really quick. Now, for those of you who don't know, A3C is the biggest hip-hop festival in the world, and it took place last month here in Atlanta. Rapzilla and shout-out to our girl, The Aaron Effect, put together some really dope events that weekend, including the Lightworks Showcase. And it has such a great lineup of artists, y'all. And the show was headlined by Indie Tribe, which is Jerry Mena, Mowgli the Iceberg, What Up RG, and of course, No Big Deal. It was really dope to see so many artists come together and be unified on one stage, supporting each other. And then it was great to see the tribe headline all together. Now, with you being a part of everything, we wanted to ask you what your experience was from your perspective. Like, how was it being able to headline, but be able to also do it with your brothers and even support your peers and friends who hit the stage that night?
Man, that was an amazing experience. I think it was like a really big moment for our genre, and especially for like kind of the younger guard, like the new era. It was a really cool moment of unity. And like, yeah, just showcasing kind of like what we got going on. But it was also an honor to be able to headline it with Indie Tribe. That's like the second, I think, full Indie Tribe show that we've had with the whole roster. It might be the first. I don't know.
Oh, wow.
But it's either the first or the second. So, yeah, we were really honored to be able to do that.
Listen, I will describe that night was honestly, I think, one of the most legendary nights, honestly, for our space. Like, it was like just to see everybody on the stage, like, honestly, anyone you could honestly think of be on the stage that night, even to see, like, you know, like we said, the unity of it all, even people who like weren't even performing that night, like,
yeah,
you know, like hitting the stage and just
right,
going in with everybody. It was really dope seeing, you know, not only you guys headline, but seeing everyone in our space as well. But listen, we got to get into this mixtape, man. We got to talk about it, the Lowercase Tape. I probably speak for all of your fans when I say that you had all of us on the edge of our seats when you would update us on how close you were to the tape being done. It's like, the tape's 90% done.
Right.
It's 97. I'm like, I wish Dill would just drop the tape already, man. This is crazy. But listen, when 100% came on, man, it was a wrap. But I want to talk about the process of creating it. You know, I know you said that it was that you take the art of mixtape very seriously. So what was the creating process like, and how did it differ from your other projects?
Man, so I really wanted to approach this one differently. And like I said, the art of the mixtape is like very important to me. So kind of long story short, I just got back. Like, I wanted to transport people back to that like golden era of the mixtapes, probably like 2006 to 2013 or something like that. Like,
yeah,
the whole Wayne era. And then we have like a whole bunch of GOATs right now that came up during that, like J. Cole and Kendrick and Big Sean and stuff like that. And so basically I went back to that piss and I literally like downloaded like all of those things that kind of shaped, downloaded all the mixtapes that shaped me growing up, and like downloaded them to my laptop, uploaded them to my phone, and like just rode around listening to them for like weeks straight, just seeing how like they were constructed and why they were so effective, and why they like captured the hearts and minds of so many people, and then tried to apply that to the project that I was working on. So it was like an immersive process. The creative process was like immersive for me.
Yeah, and I love the fact that you even mentioned that, because I had the opportunity of listening to the project again earlier today, and I could really hear all of the artists that you mentioned earlier before, like the Wayne and the Big Sean and the, you know, all these different artists that you mentioned in your music, in the mixtape, especially with your flows. Like, that catch-up joint, you really switched it up on us. And I mean, it was just really, like, legendary, even dope to even hear how you changed even over the years and developing as a true artist. Now, but lately you've been stressing the number two a lot, like on the cover of your the cover art, specifically on the mixtape, you know, seeing it on social media, specifically phase two, it seems like you're just in a different space in your artistry or even in life in general. But talk a little bit about what phase two is for you right now and why it's so significant for you at the moment.
Man, phase two, it's kind of it's like I understand it and I relate to it intuitively. I haven't really I don't have a concise way to explain it other than it's just like the second era of my artistry. And I think a main prevailing theme of it is like the first part of my career, it's just like you're just trying to, you don't even know who you are as an artist. You're just like copying what everybody else is doing. You're just trying to like get people to notice what you're trying to do, for better or for worse. You know, sometimes it's just like, man, I just want people to hear this so they can be, so that I can help them, so that I can help them heal, so they can hear my story, all that. And then sometimes it's like, man, I really just want people to respect me, to understand me as an artist, to pay attention to what I'm doing. And that's like, I feel like that was phase one. And then phase two is more just about like the freedom of the creativity and being confident in the gifts that you've been given, and using those to affect change and help other people, but just like in a free way, like an anxiety free way, and like not being attached to like numbers and charts and all that type of stuff.
That's really good. You know, I can relate to that a lot, because I feel like you move different when you're able to be secure in who you are, even like in your artistry or whatever like you're doing. So to see, honestly, like even like with hearing the tape, you can just tell that it's a different you in a sense. You know what I'm saying? Like not saying like you changed in any way, but like you've grown. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like you've evolved. So it's interesting really hearing you say that, because even through the music in itself, even like the way, I don't know, through how you move in general, you can just tell that you're just in a different space, and it's honestly really dope. But listen, guys, your girls Eminem are hanging out with the man himself, No Big Deal, and we're talking all about his new mixtape, Lowercase Tape. Now, Dale, it really shows how excited you were for this tape to drop. Like, honestly, now, what was the most exciting, or you know, even the best part about creating the mixtape?
The best part about it, it was just like following in the footsteps of all the people that I looked up to growing up, and like as it was coming together, like hearing it actually sound like it could stand with some of my favorite mixtapes of all time, like and getting my friends in on the interludes and on the features and everything, everybody just being excited about the vision, that was probably the most exciting part for me.
Yeah, now we got to talk about the tribe really quick.
We got to talk about the tribe.
We can't have Dale on the show and not talk about the tribe on the move. You know, it only makes sense.
Of course.
But your fans, supporters, you know, your family also. Now, with the tape breaking top 10 iTunes and all the love you've gotten on the project, or even from seeing and meeting them in person, does the amount of support still leave you in awe, or has it sunk in that you have such a strong support system that's always got your back?
Man, if we're talking about the fans, like, it still blows me away, like, every time, to be honest. I don't think it's going to be something that I get used to, you know. Every time I release something or I do a tour or whatever, I kind of feel like, man, is this even going to work? Are people even going to listen to this? And then the fans, the supporters always blow me away. They always, like, go above and beyond. I don't think I'll ever get used to that. It's still amazing to me.
Yeah. And the thing is I've actually come across, I think at one point in my life, somebody having a tribe tattoo. Have you come across anybody with a tattoo yet?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there were these three guys who flew to my Chicago show in the spring, in the Solar Power Tour. from Seattle, I believe, and all three of them had tribe tattoos they had gotten that day.
Wow. And that's dedication.
Yeah, shout out those three. I wish I remember their names.
Listen, the tribe goes further than just putting horses in the emoji, like, you know, in the comments. Like, it goes deeper than that. Listen, that's amazing, yo. It's so dope. I remember I walked out with my tribe hoodie on one day, and someone, like, pointed me out. They, like, ran over to me. They're like, you're any tribe? No big deal. What about you? I was like, yeah. So it's honestly really cool seeing people, like, you know, from all over just come together, like, you know, under, like, you know, the what you and, you know, all the rest of the guys have built for so long. And it's so dope seeing the unity in that. And I know you've seen a lot of them recently with the tour. Like, you know, you just wrapped the I Am tour with Futuristic, but the Family Ties tour with Stephen Malcolm and Cannon continue. So what's it been like touring with those guys, honestly, and what can we expect with the upcoming tour dates to look forward to?
Man, I've been very grateful for both of those tours. Shout out Futuristic, man, just got off that. I learned a whole lot. I'm still processing and figuring out how I'm gonna kind of like bring people in on that experience, but I just, you know, people talk about Christian artists not being welcomed in the mainstream or anything like that, but honestly, people just want excellent music. I felt like God was telling me on that tour to, because I was tempted just to do like all bangers, you know what I mean, just to impress the people, but I felt like God was saying play Suicide Nest, play Orion, which I always do in my normal sets, but I was thinking about taking them out, and so we did them every night. You know, and Suicide Nest is like, you're going to be okay because Jesus paid the debt for you. Like, it's very explicit, you know what I mean? And every night, like, people loved it. Like, they were super feeling it. People were coming up after, like, sharing stories, like, encouraging me to keep going and everything. And then the guys on the tour were the same way. They're extremely supportive. You know, people just want excellent music, and everybody wants hope and to know that they're loved and that there's a bigger picture. So that on that front, that tour was very encouraging. And then Family Ties, man, those are my guys. So that just from the first show has been incredible. Kind of getting to reconnect with Cannon on the road, because like I met Cannon like almost 10 years ago when I was interning for RMG. But we've never been on a tour together where I was an artist. So that, like, that's a cool experience. And then Steven, man, just the energy he brings. And that one is like one of the most fun tours that I've been on, but we still got like most of the tour dates left on that one. So it's going to be, now that the mixtape has been released, it's going to be like a whole nother level for these next shows. And our next one in Waukegan is like already sold out, and we got Chicago. So, that one is about to be crazy for the rest of the time.
Man, I know it's going to be absolutely Listen, I already wild. Knew
that the tour was going to be crazy, but now that the mixtape has dropped, it's going to be on another level.
And don't let them come to the ATL, Mia.
Oh, man, listen.
No, we are. We are, though.
We going up
we
to
are
ATL.
Coming to ATL.
And you know we're ready for it, so you already know that. Listen, ATL, we going all the way up.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's just how
we do
gonna
it. That's going to be crazy. I think that might be the last one, too. Yeah. So, you know, the last show is always like on 20 out of 10. So
always.
It's going to be incredible.
It's super special. And of course, I mean, the thing is like, you know, we have like this reputation when it comes to Atlanta and like so many artists that hit the city. But I don't know, maybe I'm just a little biased. I think ATL going to turn it out.
Listen, I know my city, bro. And we finna go all the way live that night.
But you can definitely expect for your girls to be in the building supporting you and the guys, of course, the best way possible. But Dill, thank you so much for hanging out with us here on this week's show. But before you go, give everybody your social media so that they can stay connected with you.
All right. You already know it's No Big Dill everywhere, at NOBIGDYL. And we're dropping merch tonight, all exclusive merch. So, like, your listeners are getting, like, an exclusive on that. Like, you guys get to know before anybody else. So,
what? Wow. New merch?
Yeah. So, yeah.
Listen,
lowercase tape merch dropping. Really right after I get off the phone.
Yo, that is insane.
Bro,
we should hang up right now.
Yeah.
Listen, yo, we're so excited for it. Make sure you guys go cop that merch when it drops, man. And also go follow No Big Dill on all social media, man. And also, go get, listen, y'all, go get this new mixtape, man. I promise you, I was so excited to watch, to listen to this tape, and even throughout the, from beginning to end, I was intrigued the entire way, man. Go get this Lowercase tape. It's sold everywhere digitally.
Yes, yes, and thanks again, Deal, for hanging out with us. You know that we've got love for you, bro. We've seriously been rocking with you since Purple Dinosaur, and that's a ways back.
Talk about it.
That's a ways back, man. But truly,
yeah, you guys are day ones for sure.
Man,
yeah.
always and forever, man. We're going to totally rock with you. But it's dope seeing you evolve as an artist and just know that you're truly an overall influencer. And, of course, you got to know that you've always got our support here on Eminem Live Radio. But we'll talk to you soon, all right?
All right, thank y'all, man.
Of course, fam. Now, to all of our listeners out there, don't go anywhere because you're about to hear that new music from Mixtape Dilly himself right now.
That's right. Yes, here's sir. Boss by No Big Deal from his new mixtape, Lowercase Tape. And, man, listen, this will go crazy. So y'all got to turn this one all the way up, and we'll be right back. You're listening to, you already know.
It's Eminem Live Radio.